slowly walking through the book of John for the last several months, trying to understand the amazing richness Apostle John has written in this book for our benefit. The sermon series Pastor JP has been preaching is aptly titled Unshakable. This book is ultimately about having assurance, assurance in the midst of life's unknowns, how we can have an unshakable confidence while we face the ups and downs in life. Now, most of you know, I think all of you know, that Apostle John, not only did he write these letters, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, he also wrote the Gospel of John, right? And if you look at both these two books, the Gospel of John and the letter 1st John, he says this. He wrote his gospel to doubters, urging them to believe. He says this in John chapter 20, verse 31. And he writes the Gospel of John to those who doubt, convincing them, telling them what it means to believe. And then he writes this letter to believers, helping them how not to doubt. Do you see the difference? One, the gospel was written to doubters to help them believe. This was written to believers to help them how not to doubt, how to have assurance in the midst of life's tragedies. Now, it's when I came to this country, I heard this for the first time, that there are two things that are inevitable in life. What are they? Death and taxes. Okay? I don't know. I think every language has some saying very similar to this. There's something that is very similar in my own language. It's not we can't repeat it in church. It's not a very polite saying, so I'll leave it out. But all languages have something very similar. Everybody has something very similar. And Bible adds a lot more to this. Bible talks about how if we are followers of Christ, we will suffer. If we are followers of Christ, we will face temptation. Sin is a daily struggle. As followers of Christ, Jesus says in his high priestly prayer, the world did not like me and they will not like you. The world did not listen to me, they will not listen to you. This is something that we go through in our life constantly. Life is filled with tragedies. Life is sometimes also pleasantly has triumphs. Sometimes we succeed and sometimes we fail. But in the midst of all of this, in these ups and downs, we must have, if we are to live a life that is unshakable, if we are to have a life of assurance, we must have a rock-solid understanding of our spiritual status, both objectively in terms of how God sees us, what God has to say when he looks at us, what does God declare about us and our faith? And subjectively, in terms of our own hearts and minds, what do we believe deep within our hearts when faced with life's uncertainties? We are told in 2 Corinthians 13:5, it says, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Or do you not realize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail to meet the test? It says, examine yourselves, test yourselves to see if you are in the faith. This is something that the Bible calls of all of us, to examine ourselves to see what is in our heart. But how can we know that Jesus Christ is really in our hearts? How can we know, as this word says in 2 Corinthians, as we examine ourselves to see what is in our heart, to see what do we believe, how can we know that Jesus Christ is in our hearts? That is the question. And this passage that was read to us by Benita, that is exactly what this passage is going to answer. But before we begin, we must look at something that is fundamental to everything that John writes, fundamental to how John thinks. It comes from an encounter John has very early on in the gospel. This man, the leader of Pharisees, Nicodemus, comes to John and comes to Jesus, and John writes this encounter. What is that encounter about? What is that one word, one phrase, that whole, born again. So this man comes to Jesus, and Jesus tells Nicodemus, he tells him, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." Okay, so here is the link, here is the chain. 2 Corinthians says, "Test yourself, examine yourself to see if Christ Jesus is in you." But Christ Jesus is not in us unless we are born again. Then the question becomes, just pushing it further, how can we know that we are born again? How do we know that we are born again? What is the test? What is the evidence? And with that, we come to our passage. That's exactly what this author wants to talk to us. Now, before we talk about the word born again, this work of God in our hearts is variously described in the Bible. Sometimes it says born again, sometimes Bible says born of God. Sometimes it talks about born from above. And theologians, they like to coin their own words and they call it regeneration. Okay? These are all terms that explain the same thing. But having answered all of that, with that introduction, let's ask, what are the ways in which we can know that we are born again? And there are four tests that John gives in these verses that we just read. The first test is called the doctrinal test, or the test of saving faith. The second test is called the social test, the test of brotherly love. The third test is called the moral test, the test of delightful obedience. And then the last test, the fourth test, is the martial test, test of certain victory. So there are four tests: a doctrinal test, a social test, a moral test, and a martial test. Okay? So Pastor JP printed the bulletins on 2 pages, so you'll have a lot of space to take notes. Okay? The first test of doctrinal test is Godward. It is between us and aimed towards God, is Godwards. The social test is man, between us and the others in the household of God. The third test, or the moral test, is inward. It is within us. And then the last, or the fourth test, the martial test, is outward. Thus, these four tests cover all orientations of man: how man relates to God, how man relates within the household of God, how man relates to himself, and how he relates to the world outside. Robert Law, who wrote one of the most influential commentary on the book of 1 John, he calls his commentary itself the tests of faith. That's the title of his commentary, the tests of faith. Because to John, this is the most fundamental thing: understanding what it means to be born again. So with that, let's turn to the first test. This is in first half of 1 John chapter 5, verse 1. And it reads, "Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God." Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. Now, apologize for this. We'll look at grammar, little bit of grammar. Okay? There are two verbs in this verse. First verb is who believes. Now that's a present tense. It is talking about everyone must daily and continually believe that Jesus is Christ. It is an action that is happening every day in our lives. Okay, there is another verb in this verse, which is has been born of God. Unfortunately, this particular tense in Greek is not, we do not have an equivalent in English. In Greek, it's called perfect tense. A perfect tense in Greek is an action that has happened in the past, is fully completed, but has consequences in the present. Okay, a particular action that is done, it's over, it's finished, it happened way back in the past, but it continues to have ripple effects in our life today. Okay, so what does that all mean? What John is saying is we must first be born of God, and this present status of being born of God enables us to believe that Jesus is Christ. In other words, there is a very specific order when it comes to being born of God and believing. the first test. First, we must be born of God. And then comes the saving faith. In fact, if that is the order, the saving faith itself becomes an indication and evidence that we are born again. See, often we think that it is faith that saves us. Often we think that we believe and therefore we are saved. But John reverses the order. He says, unless you are born of God, unless this born above, born from God, unless this regeneration happens first in our lives, we cannot have saving faith. And on the contrary, or looking at it from the other way, if you have saving faith in your hearts, it's the evidence that you are born again. It is crucial to understand, because you will hear a lot of people, a lot of preachers, evangelists who take this and turn it around. Commonly we hear people talking about popular evangelism or crusades to pray the sinner's prayer. And then they say, okay, now that you have prayed the prayer, you have become a Christian. So the implication is that you have prayed and you have believed and therefore you have become a Christian. But what John is saying is, unless you are regenerated first, you cannot have saving faith. Faith is only effective in those who have been regenerated, who have been born of God. But why is this so? Why is it like this? Why must it be this way? Why is it that we must be born of God before we can say yes to faith? Turn to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. And Paul answers this question very simply. So the question before us is, why must we be born again? Why must we be born of God before we can have saving faith? And Paul says, because you are dead. It's as simple, because we are all dead people. And this is what Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. Okay? Paul is emphatic when he says that we are all dead people. Dead in our trespasses and sins and subject to the wrath of God. Now you remember the story of Lazarus, right? How many days was Lazarus in the tomb before he was resurrected? Or he was raised from dead? Anybody remember? 4 days. Good job, you passed the test. See, Lazarus may have been dead for only 4 days, but we have been in the tomb of our sins and trespasses from the day we were born. Psalm 51 verse 5 says, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Just as Lazarus could not raise himself from dead, he needed Jesus to come and call him out. We cannot raise ourselves back to life because we are dead. Dead people are dead. You can't get any deader than dead, right? Dead people can't do anything other than to stay eminently dead. That's all they can do. Unlike whatever the movie show, don't believe them, okay? Dead people are dead. But Paul does not stop here in Ephesians chapter 2. Verse 4, he continues, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, there comes again, we were dead in our trespasses and sins. We are buried in the tomb of our sins and trespasses. And he says this, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We were dead in our sins and trespasses. We were buried in the tomb. And Jesus comes along and he calls us out. Paul is very clear when he says that this is not something that we have done on our own, but it is the gift of God. Not a result of our works, because of the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. It's not anything. Dead people can do anything. Before we can repent of our sins, before we can submit to faith, we must be made alive, we must be born again. And only after we are born again do we receive the gift of faith. Only after we are born again, only after we are made alive, are we able to say we believe. Knowing that our faith journey begins with God regenerating us, we have this confidence that Paul talks about in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Paul writes, "Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." We're talking, this whole series has been about how to live unshakable lives. The whole series has been about how to have assurance in the midst of life struggles, when tragedies strike us. And Paul is saying how to have confidence, because he who began a good work in us will carry it on to completion. Now, why is that important? Why do we get confidence realizing that it is God who begins this work? This is something I've learned from my children, so I will use it on you. Okay, consider two different worlds. Okay, in one world, let's say the decision to faith starts with you. You made the decision. You decided to become a Christian. Now, what happens? We know within inside of us what kind of people we are. We vacillate. We make oaths that we do not keep. We think we have made decisions, but we are not sure. 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, we don't know. Did I really say yes? Did I say no? Always doubts in our life. We can never have confidence if we start with a man making a decision for Christ, because we are very fickle-minded people. We change. We don't know. But let's consider the other world. As Paul says, he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion. If our faith journey started with God, with him making us alive from being dead, what do we have? We have confidence that he who began a good work in us will carry it on to completion. That is how we live unshakable lives, because we understand that it is God who began the work and it is God who completes the work. Okay, that's the first test. Let's move on to the second test. We find this test in the second half of verse 1. 1 John chapter 5, later half of verse 1. Everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. So the first test is the doctrinal test, or the test of saving faith. The second test is the social test, or the test of brotherly love. Everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. Now, the same Robert Law, I talked about him writing this commentary on 1 John, the tests of life. He says this, he describes the 1 John as a spiral staircase. Now, what happens in a spiral staircase? Have you ever seen one of those? A staircase that goes round and round? So, as you climb up a spiral staircase, what happens? You come back to the same view. Every time you come around the staircase, you come back to the same view. You're seeing the same thing over and over and over again. This book is just like that. It is like a spiral staircase. John comes back to the same themes again and again and again and again and again because of their importance. So here we're talking about everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. This idea of loving others is so important to John. In 5 chapters, he repeats this 11 times. I will not give you the list. If you want, you can come see me afterwards. But it is supremely important to John. But I will read two of them. 1 John chapter 3, verse 14. 1 John chapter 3, verse 14. He says, "We know that we have passed out of death into life." Okay, what does that mean, from death into life? What does that sound like? Being born again, right? Same thing. We know that we have passed from death into life because we love the brothers. Whoever does not love abides in death, or he has never been born again. So here is again, he's repeating the same thought. The evidence of being born again is that you love the brothers. Okay, 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. 1 John 4, 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for the love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Okay, so crucial. First test, if you are born of God, you will demonstrate saving faith. Second test, if you are born of God, you will love the brothers and sisters in the household of God. To borrow an illustration from Eric Alexander, think of a human family. Okay, all of us are part of human families. What are two things that are common to all families? One thing is a parental love, and the other is love among members of the family. Right? It is a natural thing for parents to love their children. What happens if you come across a family where parents abuse children? That's abnormal. That's shocking. That's, you know, comes up in the news. Nobody talks about if a family, father, parents love their children. That is not newsworthy. Nobody talks about it. Why? Because it's normal. It happens in a lot of families. Same thing, what about in the case of a brother who loves a sister, or children who love other members in the family, or family members loving each other? That's normal. That is what a family, human family, is ought to look like. But same thing would apply to a Christian family, doesn't it? If what happens if in a Christian family a brother does not love a brother, a sister does not love a sister, there are struggles within the family of God, then it becomes abnormal. It becomes outside the norm of what God and how the family is constituted. So when we look at a human family where such a love does not exist, we call it as dysfunctional. When we talk about a God's family where such love does not exist, we call it unspiritual. And unspiritual, according to 1 John chapter 3, verse 14, is another word, synonym for not being born again. Everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. Paul says in Romans 13:8, he says, we must not owe any debt to anybody except one, that of love. Why? Why is it that? Why is it that that is one debt we cannot pay back? It is because we receive so much love from each other that you can never pay it back. That is one debt we will always carry and must carry, the love for our brothers and sisters. That is one debt we can never repay. But how does such a love look like? I mean, we talk about love, you know, love, we must love one another and all of that. How does it look like? 1 John 3:16. He likes 3:16, John 3:16, 1 John 3:16. By the way, if you are interested, there is a, how many of you, a lot of you are computer science people, how many of you know Dan Knuth? Okay, there's one, okay, few. Dan Knuth went out and commissioned a book called 3:16, which is all the verses, 3:16 verses in every book of the Bible. Okay, as much wherever there are chapter 3s. And he commissioned artists to paint what they think that verse is talking about. It's a very interesting book. You should take a look at it. But this is what John says in 1 John 3:16. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. Love is sacrificial. It's often easy to say we love somebody when it is out of the plenty that we have. I have, let's say, $100 million. Giving $10 is not a problem. I won't even know it. Okay? But I have $3 and I have to give all three of them. That is love. That is sacrifice. And when Jesus came to this earth, he did not leave anything behind. It says he emptied himself of all his glory. He put it all away. He gave it all up for us. That is love. That is sacrifice. To love somebody out of plenty is easy, and we don't even do that. And how are we going to love God and people sacrificially? But that's what John says. That is how we are to love. But how do we get to this kind of love? This kind of sacrificial love? How do we find it? How do we get to this? How do we have that kind of love towards one another? There is a story that Luke talks about in 7:47. This woman comes to Jesus and she anoints his feet. And then the Pharisee starts grumbling. He says, "Do you not know who this woman is?" And Jesus, talking to Pharisees, says this. Listen, Luke chapter 7, verse 47. "Therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little." Why is it that we find hard to love others? Because we have been forgiven little. There is this mistaken notion that once we repent, we are freed from the sorrow of sin. And I don't think that is true. We are freed from the guilt of sin, but not from the sorrow of sin. Because Christ has paid the penalty for the sorrow, for the guilt of sin. But as he transforms us, we only grow deeper in how sinful we are, how utterly depraved we are. So this is the mark of a Christian maturity, that we grow, we go from our awareness of sin, ever-increasing awareness of sin, we realize how fallen we are every single day of our life. So the sorrow of sin grows only deeper. But to counteract that, our understanding of grace goes that much more as well. That's what Jesus is saying. Who is forgiven little loves little. Who is forgiven much loves much. What does he mean? If we understand, as we grow in the depth of our sorrow for our sins, we understand the grace of God that much more. And because we understand the grace of God that much more, we are able to love one another that much more. There is no magic formula. This is it. We want to learn how to love others. Start by learning how much we have been forgiven. There's no other way. Let me put this another way. What kind of church would you like to be part of? Do you like to be part of a church where there's a lot of infighting and jealousies and gossip and dysfunctionality? Or one that is marked by a growing awareness of both sin and therefore increasing love towards one another? Would you rather go to a church where the program is top-notch, the technical skills are displayed and the abilities displayed is wonderful, and the PowerPoint is great and all of that? Is that the kind of church you want to go to, or one where people care for people? I think the answer is easy, isn't it? But guess what? You are the church. If you would like to go to a church that is marked by love, then be the church that is known for its love for one another. One who is born again does not wait to see if others will love him or her, but will be the one who is loving others, setting them an example as Jesus did. He died while we were still enemies. We love those who are of the family of God. Hugely different challenges. He died for enemies. We are called to love the family of God. Right? If we are born again, we should be in the front, loving one another. We are the church. We can't wait and sit in our places and say, "Oh, nobody loves me, they don't talk to me, they don't care for me." You be the ones who go out there and talk to people. You be the ones who go out there and love one another. That's our calling. That's what we are called to do. If you're born again, this is what we must do to love one another. Okay, that's the second test. The first test was the doctrinal test, the second was the social test, and the third test is the moral test, or the test of delightful obedience. This comes from 1 John chapter 5, verses 2 and 3. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. Okay, let me make it very clear. Love of God is not equal to keeping His commandments. Sometimes people read these words and they'll think, love of God is equal to keeping His commandments. If we love God, it does not automatically mean that we keep His commandments. Okay, for sure, loving God includes keeping His commandments, but it is much more than that. And I will illustrate shortly what do I mean by that. But to understand this test, the clue comes to us from verse 3, where it says, His commandments are not, what does it say? Are not burdensome. So rightly paraphrased, one who is born again finds the commandments of God delightful. Okay, that is the posture of somebody who's born again, that we find His commandments delightful. We don't find them burdensome. They are not drudgery. They don't require sheer willful effort from us to keep them, because why? We find them delightful. We enjoy doing those things because we are born of God. What did Jesus say in Matthew 11:30? He says, "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Psalm 112 verse 1 says, "Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in His commandments." Psalm 119 verse 35, "Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it." Psalm 119 verse 47, "For I find my delight in your commandments which I have." His commandments are delightful for those who are born of God. Loving God means appreciating and enjoying God so much that His will for our life is not a burden, but instead a great delight. Okay, something this author did when he wrote these words, he said, love of God and commandments of God, he put them, both of them together, right? In today's world, love has been exalted to such a virtue and such a high status that we are supposed to love one another and never call into question their lifestyle choices. Because it is not a loving thing to do, to question somebody, the choices that they make. That's what the world says. Look at your Bible. Bible says we must love one another. Bible says you must love God and love one another, just as Christ has loved you. So how can you judge others? That's what they say. But John is very clear. You cannot love God. You cannot say that I love God and not love His commandments. They both go together. You cannot love somebody and then ignore the lifestyle choices they make if they are contrary to the commandments of God. That is not a loving thing to do. That is paving their way to hell with good intentions. And it is not appropriate according to the Bible, according to what John says. When we love somebody, we love them, we love God, and we also love His commandments. So the first test, a doctrinal test, is the test of saving faith. Those who are born again will have a saving faith in Jesus Christ. The second test, or the social test, is the test of brotherly love. Those who are born again will love their brothers and sisters with sacrificial love. The third, or moral test that we just saw, was the test of delightful obedience. Those who are born again will not find the commandments of God burdensome, but delightful. The last test is the martial test, the test of certain victory. We find this in chapter 5, verses 4 to 5. "For everyone who's been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God?" So everyone who's born of God overcomes the world. This test is aptly named the martial test. There is a war that is being waged between God and His enemies. But there is one crucial difference about this war compared to all the other wars that we know of, or all the other wars in history. And what is that? That crucial difference is the victory is already determined. The end is already set. Satan has done his utmost to strike the heel of the Son of Man, and it only resulted in his head being crushed. John writes in 1 John 3:18 how the Son of Man has appeared to destroy the works of the devil. Devil is a defeated foe. He's been reduced merely slinking around trying to figure out how to distract the people of God from the purposes of God. But he's unable to thwart the inexorable and inevitable progress of God's plans and purposes for all of us and for his world. Devil can do nothing about what God wants to accomplish. He is a defeated foe. And those of us who are born again, we are overcomers. Paul talks about us in Romans 8. He calls us actually more than conquerors. In fact, if you look at the Greek, the literal translation would be we are super conquerors. We are conquerors of conquerors. That's how we are described. And Paul also says in 2 Corinthians 2:14, but thanks be to God who is in Christ, always leads us in a triumphal procession and through us spreads the fragrance of knowledge of him everywhere. We are being led, who in Christ always leads us in triumphal procession. It's not future thing. It's not something that will happen in the future. Christ is always leads us in triumphal procession. Okay? Now, after the recent Super Bowl, many of you have seen it. Philadelphia Eagles, they are the ones who won, right? Okay, Philadelphia Eagles, they went back to their hometown and they had a victory parade, right? But it was a wonderful parade. All the people who contributed to the victory were part of the parade. They were serenaded through the streets of Philadelphia and they had a good time. Now imagine this, and next year the parade, hopefully some other team will win and the parade will happen in that city, right? But how many of you know of any team that is planning a victory parade today for next year? Do you know of anybody who's doing that? How about 2020? How about 2021? You wish that Niners would be the ones doing the planning. Nobody does, because they don't know who will win. But we do. And so, Paul promises that we will be part of our victory parade because the victory is assured. And that is why John says, those who are born of God are overcomers with Christ Jesus because he has won the victory, and in union with him, we also participate in that victory. And how can we be assurance? How can we know that we will victory, will win this victory? Or how can we know that we in our personal lives will be victorious? And 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, he says this, little children, you are from God and have overcome them, for he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Okay, not only are we victorious because we are united with Christ Jesus in his victory, we personally will overcome because he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. That is why Paul says we are super conquerors. We are more than conquerors. With that, we come to the last and final test. We looked at four tests to know how can we have assurance that we are born again. Okay, we looked at the doctrinal test, the test of saving faith, the social test, or test of brotherly love, the moral test, or the test of delightful obedience, and the martial test, or the test of certain victory. Let me conclude, and allow me the luxury of changing the metaphor on you. I've been using the word test, or the metaphor of test, to explain what John has written for us in these verses, but let me change that metaphor and talk about human traits. Now, most of you do this. I've seen many of you do this. So you go to somebody, they have just had a baby, just had a child. You look at the baby's features, you look at the nose, the eyes, the ears, the forehead, the hair, and you say, oh, the baby looks like mom, or like the baby looks like dad. Why? You can look at physical features, human traits, and then identify the family to whom that child belongs. We do this all the time, don't we? Now, in my family, we take one step further. So if my kids do something really wonderful, my wife will say, oh, they have taken after me. And if they do really something naughty or bad, she will say they're taken after the father. It should be. Okay, I don't know how that works. I don't know how much of that is true. But even as we look at these tests that I just mentioned, the four tests, or the traits, if you would have, isn't there a problem? How many of us can say that we pass these tests or possess these traits with confidence? For example, first test was the test of saving faith, but my faith is filled with doubts. When I should have steadfast faith in the midst of a trouble, I falter and flounder, doubting God and His goodness. Does it mean then that I am not born again? Or my brotherly love for each other is far from perfect? I mean, I don't even know, and I'm being very honest, there are many people here, I don't know you all that well. And if I don't even know you all that well, how can I love you like the way Christ has loved us? And maybe it's not true just of me, maybe it is true of others of you as well. So does that mean then I am not born again because I don't display this kind of brotherly love that God expects of us? I find God's commandments difficult. They're often burdensome. They're hard. To live holy life is very hard in face of sin and temptation. I don't find them delightful. They're hard. So does it mean then I am not born again? My life is far from victorious. Does it mean then that I am not born again? Most days we fail the test that John has been describing in this. More often than not, we don't display the traits of the household of God. And the problem is even worse when we think about this. We know how we ought to be. And we know how we are. And the gap is so huge and so wide that it's so painful to realize that I can't get there. I cannot be like this person that I know I should be. Right? When we think about these traits and these tests, we fail them all the time. So what does that mean? Does it mean that we're not born again? John writes again in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. Watch this. Then he says this, crucial. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. We have an advocate in heaven. He is our righteousness. We have an advocate who has believed perfectly. He loved sacrificially, not dying just for his friends and disciples, brothers and sisters, but for us. We were enemies. He died for us. He obeyed unflinchingly, delighting in the will of God, his Father. In fact, he says, it is my food to do the will of my Father. That is how much delight he had in obeying God. And he was perfect in his obedience. He vanquished his enemies. I should practice the word. He vanquished his enemies completely and unequivocally. Yes. They're done. They're defeated. Sin, Bible, in fact, Paul writes, death, where is thy sting? It's gone, right? Not only has he passed all of these tests perfectly, he took his score and he put it in my report card. So when I go to God the Father and show him my report card, it does not show zeros, but it shows perfect score because Christ has passed every single test. His righteousness has become my righteousness. His perfect obedience has now become my perfect obedience. And in him is my assurance, not in my ability to pass these tests, not in my ability to display these traits that God demands of those who are born again, but in the fact that Christ has done these things for us. And that is the source of my unshakable confidence. And that is why I'm able to say, I have confidence in this, that he who began a good work will carry it on to completion in me. Not because I am capable, but because he started the work, he kept the faith, and he will take me to the end. Now, there may be some of you who are thinking here, well, if Christ did everything, if Christ has done it all, why should I bother? Why should I do any of these things? Can't I just go home, live my life merrily, and never worry about any of these things? But then let me ask you, if you're thinking that way, let me ask you, are you born again? Because those who are born again will not ask that question. Those who are born again take these tests seriously, but realize and understand that it is not their performance that gets them into heaven, but only the perfect obedience of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Ultimately, he is the source of our unshakable confidence. So then the question is, are you born again? How do you know? And we are back at the beginning of the sermon.